morning, Impact Church. We just want to thank God this morning that we can meet again. It has been some time, and I know that this is the third day of the lockdown in the Republic of South Africa. We just want to thank God for this opportunity that He has given it to us, for us to meet this morning. I know we are not meeting in our traditional buildings, but God is still good. Let me welcome the guys in Clayville, the guys in Cosmo, the guys in Lanseria. We just want to thank you for continuing to pray with us as the leadership of the church. And we just want to thank you for your support and then for sticking together during this time. We have said to all of us that after this experience, we are aware that the church will not be the same again. And God is doing something that all of us, we need to follow Him and hear what He's saying to us during this time. And so this morning, it's an opportunity once more for us to sit together around God's word. And before we do that, I really would want to pray for all of you as you are going about doing all that you're doing. And this morning, having dedicated this moment and this time just to sit, to come and hear God's word together. Let me pray for all of us. And Father, we want to thank you for your word. We thank you this morning that you are a faithful God. You are not a son of man that can lie. You are always with us. You love us. You keep us safe. You are the God of heaven. And this morning, even as we come together from our different homes just to sit around your word, we pray that the Holy Spirit will come and illuminate the truths of your word. And as all of us are listening and saying, speak to us. In Jesus' precious name, we thank you and we honor you. Amen. So having said that, I really want to take this opportunity to welcome all our church members, wherever you are, all our three sites. Let me take this opportunity once more to say to you, keep on trusting God, keep on praying together as a family, never lose hope. In actual fact, we always said to all of you that the church is not about the building, but is the relationship that we have with God together. Where two or three are gathered together in His name, He is there. And so this is an opportunity for us to go back. And I mean, it reminds me of the church in the book of Acts, where people were meeting in their homes, breaking bread together, sharing things in common. And I'm wondering if God is just not taking us back there just to experience what is it to be together, just to have that kind of fellowship again, and just to be in small groups again, just to be in touch with each other and be able to pray together as families. And I really believe that God is doing something, and at the end of this process, we will see what is it that God is saying to us as a church. This morning, I really want to go back to something that it may sound easy, and it may sound that we know that, it may sound like, but why are we going back there? Why are we talking about that? But the issue that I want to address this morning is this one. Is that we've always maintained that Jesus is building His church. Jesus is building His church. And I really want to go back to a text that many people have heard me talk about it several times, because I contend that the church of Jesus belongs to Him. We may have changed it, we may have put some stuff in it, but it remains His church and not our church. And so today I want to go back to a text that we all know, and most probably some of you are already there with your Bibles, and you are like, we know He's going to go to that text, and I really want to go there. Let's go to the book of Matthew chapter 16, and I'm going to read from verse 13 to 20, because there's something about what Jesus says here in relation to what is happening today. So if you are there, I'm reading from the NIV version of the Bible, and it reads as follows from verse 13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, He asked His disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" He asked, "Who do you say I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by men, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. And verse 20 says, then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. We come into a text that is so pregnant with so many things in it. And this is how I want us to approach it this morning. I want us to approach it with a view that Jesus already said in verse 18, and on this rock, I, Jesus, will build my church. But this is how I want us to look at it. Jesus takes his disciples out, and they've been preaching for quite some time. I mean, they've been with him almost 2.5 years now, and Jesus was preparing himself to go to the cross, to go to Jerusalem, to be crucified. And now he takes them out, and he takes them to a place called Caesarea Philippi. And when he arrives there, he does quite a number of things with them in terms of the statements that are coming out of that text. And this is how I want us to look at it. Number one, in verse 15, you realize that Jesus asks his disciples a question. He asks his disciples a question. And number two, in verse 14, Jesus gets what I call the group answer. So he asks them a question, number one. Number two, he gets the group answer. Number three, in verse 15, he asks them a counter question. And in verse 17, he gets what I termed an individual answer. In 17, after getting the individual answer, he makes a pronouncement. In verse 18, then he makes what I call a proclamation, which is, on this church I'll build my church, but we'll come back to that. And in verse 19, he makes a promise. So let's go back and see how I look at this thing, because it is important for us to understand some certain things here. The reason Jesus asked this question was the fact that these guys have been with him for quite some time. And so he wanted to understand if they know who he was. So when he asked the question, the group answers, they give him a number of options in terms of the answer that he's looking for. And then they tell him, you know, we hear people saying you are Jeremiah, you are one of the prophets, and they're giving him this answer as a group. And Jesus says, no, it's good, I hear what you're saying. But he asked them a counter question, and he says, but what about you? And I'm asking you because I want to check if you know who I am. And something very interesting happens here. He gets what I called an individual answer. Peter comes and says, hey, it looks like I know the answer to that question. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And you can imagine, at that time, Peter would have felt like, out of the group answer, I am the only guy who got the real answer or the right answer. And now Jesus would call him, blessed are you, son of John. He pronounces a blessing. Blessed are you, son of John. But the next thing that Jesus does, which is very important for us to understand, he makes sure that Peter knows that the answer he gave did not come from him. No matter how good Peter thought he could be, but Jesus is making sure that he understands that, Peter, this answer does not come from you. No flesh or blood can reveal this thing to you. It comes from my Father in heaven. And so after that, Jesus makes something that is very interesting. Because this man has given him the answer, Jesus makes a very serious proclamation in front of them. And he says, now on this rock, on the answer you've given, I will build my church. And that is key, friends. It's key this morning. And the reason why we're talking about that Jesus said he was going to build his church, I can tell you even today, Jesus is sitting in heaven. Corona is here, but Jesus is sitting in heaven and says, I am building my church. Any other thing that we are building is not going to be sustained during the coronavirus time or during this crisis. But let me tell you, when Jesus said, and on this rock I'll build my church, he gave a promise, and he says, the church that I'm building, the gates of hell, whether it's sickness, whether it's war, whether it's whatever that happens in the world, the church that I, Jesus, am building, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And that's why this morning I want to talk to you about understanding the kind of the church that Jesus was building. He made a promise about it. So almost everything that people built, when you hear sometimes people worried about so many other things, they could be worried. You may even think that people are worried about the church of Jesus Christ. But you may be shocked that some of the people are not even worried about the church of Jesus Christ. Some of us as pastors are worried about other things other than the church of Jesus Christ. Others are worried about what are they going to eat from here, because maybe the tithes and offerings are not going to come. Others are worried about so many other things. And others are worried about, hey, look, every Sunday I stand in front of 15,000 people. They listen to me, and now I can't even stand in front of 100. They say 99. Now we are in a lockdown. I can't even preach in front of anyone except sitting in my family. Others are worried about so many other things. And I can tell you now that Jesus knew that this situation was going to come, and it's not going to affect how he builds his church. We definitely as human beings will be worried. We as human beings will definitely get ourselves into positions and try and look at that and look at that. And there's nothing wrong. And I'm not knocking these things down. And I'm not knocking what people are doing. All I'm saying is, if Jesus said he was going to build his church, he knew that in 2020, there will be this virus called coronavirus. And it will affect all nations in the whole world. And yet, his church cannot be affected in the sense that he is building it stronger, because right in the midst of the crisis, Jesus' church is surviving. If you look at the book of Acts, it will give you a hint of what had happened. The book of Acts uses words like, in those days, a great persecution broke against the church. But once that came in, and it says these people were spread all over, and in actual fact, the more they spread, the more the gospel went into areas that it would have never gone had persecution not come. And I'm not suggesting for any moment to say that coronavirus, it's some kind of something that is a trouble that God sent from heaven. I'm not in that space. All I'm showing you is that it doesn't matter where the situation is and where do we find ourselves as Christians. If Jesus is building his church, I can tell you now, it doesn't matter who says what, doesn't matter what happens, he will build his church. And these are the prophetic words of every situation that has ever happened or come against the church. You see me this morning, I'm preaching and I'm talking to you from my study in my house. Who has ever thought that I would have to sit here and talk to you from your homes, right, confined in my own house? But let me tell you, the gospel still goes out irrespective of what is happening out there, irrespective of the lockdown, irrespective of all these new laws that have been put around us. The gospel is still going out, and you are able to hear me. That's exactly what Jesus said he was going to build his church. So let's look at this text, and I'm really wanting to help us so that we understand that going forward in the season that we find ourselves, if we were not building well, if we were not building with Jesus, I would want to help all of us to go back, that when this thing has gone, when this virus and everybody is back to work and things are normal and all, we need to remain with these weights, that we cannot do church the way we're doing it unless it is the way Jesus would want the church to be done. And so these are a few things that I really would want us to look at them. A key verse here is verse 18, and Jesus tells them, he says, and on this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Number one, and something that maybe we need to know and learn in this crisis, is that the church belongs to Christ. It is his. He went to the cross to die for the church. He loved us even while we were still sinners. He made sure that we live lives that we are living today, because he gave his life for the church that he said he was going to build. So today we will learn, even from my home, where I'm preaching from, that I don't need a building to have 15,000 or 10,000 or 10 people or 50 people
for Jesus to build his church. In actual fact, I don't even need to stand in front of millions of people to try and say, look at how my church has grown, because it has got nothing to do with me. So number one, I want you to understand that the church belongs to him. It is his. And wherever you are today, in whatever space that you are confined to, you must know you belong to him because he has called you by your name. He wanted you to be part of what he's doing. So Jesus owns the church. And this crisis shows us that it's got nothing to do with me leading a church. It's got nothing to do with you leading something or being gifted this way or gifted that way. It's got everything to do with the fact that Jesus promised that he's going to build his church and he's doing it well. So you must understand from today going forward that the church belongs to Christ. Ownership is his. So out of this situation, I'm going to be able to say, I've been talking to you from my house, and none of you was in front of me, and I was still able to preach the message that says you belong to Christ. So I don't feel like I need to be somewhere else where people will clap hands for me because I've preached the word. But I will need to be here and say, Jesus loves you no matter what, because he died for you, he gave his life for you, therefore you are owned by him. Okay, let me give you a text. If you read in 2 Corinthians 5:15, it reads as follows, and he says, he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them. Now you see, it actually shows that Jesus said, I was going to build my church. And how was he going to build it? For all. That those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them. Now, if this situation did not happen, you would go and visit so many other churches or congregations or wherever people meet. You will be mistaken to come into other churches and feel like Jesus is not here. Actually, the guy who preaches owns these people. But you see, 2 Corinthians 5:15 says, because Jesus died for us, so that we can no longer live for ourselves, but live for him. That makes a huge difference. So that says to me, wherever you are this morning, in your house, with your children, with all the members of your household, you can be assured that Jesus loves you, died for you, and you can live for him. Now, some of these problems that are created in our local churches, they are created by us as people, as human beings, including myself as a preacher. They're created by us because we want to believe that we own the church. We want to believe that everything that we say to people, we are saying it because they owe us something. In actual fact, this scripture says to us, we live for him who died for us. So today, it says, one, if you are not prayerful, it is not going to be covered by us coming together and praying and you feel like you've prayed. But you need to start learning on how to pray and have devotional disciplines, because you belong to Christ, because you live for him. And so if you don't pray, if you don't study the word, if your family can't sit together around the table and break bread and appreciate Jesus, then this scripture does not apply to you, in the sense that you always believe that you belong to a particular pastor because you have to go to their church every Sunday. So Jesus is building his church. Doesn't need you, doesn't need me, because he's building his church. In Titus chapter 2 verse 14, and it reads as follows, and it says, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own. You know what becomes a problem during this time? If anybody had believed that people belong to him, you will realize that in actual fact, Titus chapter 2:14 says, Jesus died for us and he purified for himself a people that are his very own. You realize that when you are not in the pulpit and there are no 15,000 people in front of you, you realize that in actual fact, these people belong to Jesus because he died for them. Now, for the first time, it dawns on you that actually the church belongs to him. It is his. All these scriptures are telling us it is his, because he said he was going to build it. One of the things that I find very difficult now, it's when people feel like, you know what, we need to try and make sure that we keep these people to ourselves. Let me tell you what God is doing. He's wanting us to set his people free so that they can worship him freely. So once this thing is gone, we will be so humbled as we lead his people. None of us will think that I am a better person or I'm better than any other person. I mean, I see this thing with people like ourselves, those who are gifted, either in being prophetic, either in being in preaching, either in teaching, either in being a good evangelist, whatever gift you have. We have tended the church to belong to us. That's why I feel like, yo, I don't even know what to say to this guy when he says, come to me, you will be healed. And I'm like, no. Come to Jesus and Jesus will heal you. And now it will show you that when this situation removes us from people who think they own us, you will realize that today Jesus can visit you wherever you are, in your home, and heal you there. Because we have owned this thing so much that Jesus is looking at it and is like, but this is not the church that I own. It looks like this is the church that guy thinks he has died for. And so now, we are made to understand that wherever we are, we can access the throne of grace with boldness. Because I don't need the pastor to go to approach the throne of God. Are pastors not right? No, they are. We play a very important role in the life of the church. In actual fact, God organized this church the way he did so that we can have leaders in the life of the church. But when we miss the point that Jesus is building his church and it belongs to him, and we want to make these people to belong to us, that's where we have a problem. But that's where many people today, they will sit in their homes and not know where to go and what to do. They will always want to phone or check and say, hey, let me check. What must we do? Can't we do that? And I'm like, actually, God is showing us that he needs you to trust him. So that next time when we are together, you know, it's not about the guy in front. It's not about the person next door. It's not about the good preacher. It's not about the prophet that God has given. It's not about the miracle worker. It is about Christ, because he is building his church. And this is the promise he made. He said, the church that I'm building, no hell can come against it. Now you're sitting somewhere and you're feeling like, yeah, it looks like hell has broken out against us. This coronavirus thing. And Jesus is sitting there. It's like, I am building my church, and even coronavirus cannot prevail against my church, because that's the kind of the church he's building. But if it is mine, I'll be worried. If it is mine, I'll be thinking, yo, when we go back, how many people will still come back to where I am? Let me tell you, I want to know how many people will still belong to Christ, will still say, we have seen the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living during the coronavirus lockdown. Then we will know that Jesus was building his church. In 1 Peter 2:9, one of the texts that we know and we love, it reads as follows. It says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. You know what I love about what is happening now? Is the fact that for the first time, if you are not praying for yourself, if you are not praying for your family, if you are not reading the word, if you are not in the devotions, you can't blame Tsoai. You can't say, yeah, no, today we didn't even have an intercessory prayer at church. You will realize that in actual fact, you have moved away from belonging to Christ to have shifted that responsibility to Tsoai as your pastor. So Peter put it there, and he says, we are a people belonging to God, that we may declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness. So wherever you are, it's an opportunity, it's a moment to praise God, to honor him, to worship him, so that when we meet, there are testimonies. You know, I love how Paul and his team will go in the book of Acts, they will go out and leave the church in Antioch and go and all. When they come back, it will say they will call all the believers and report to them what God has done. I'm hoping that the day we meet, as we come back together, I'll hear reports, I'll hear miracles, I'll hear people saying, you know what, God visited us in our house. God came through for us. God broke through into the situation that we find ourselves, and we were sick, things were not happening, but that moment God came through and broke into our lives. That will excite me, because then I'll know that Jesus is building his church. In actual fact, I've got nothing to do with how he built it. All I need to do is to be faithful with the little that he has given me, to lead you when he has given me the opportunity to lead you. The next text that I want you to hear, because it's around that. It's just around that. John chapter 17, verse 24. Jesus is praying and he says, "Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am. Those you have given me to be with me where I am." So it means the Father has given us to Jesus by the action of Jesus going to the cross, dying for us on the cross. Therefore, we belong to him. And so this morning, as you go about looking at your children, your wife, your husband, and you know, and you're listening to me, I want this thing to dawn on you, to understand that in actual fact, you are in a better place today to honor God because you belong to him. God gave you to Jesus, and Jesus made sure that by going to the cross, he was going to complete what the Father wanted him to complete. So in this text, the disciples most probably were shocked, because all the answers they gave, that some say you're Jeremiah or Elijah, one of the prophets, and Jesus was not interested in that. And they were thinking, but where is this guy going with this thing? And once he declared that on this rock I'll build my church, you will realize that things changed. And he turned almost everything upside down. And so these are a few things that I want you to take away from me this morning. One, Jesus is building his church and he is not going to fail it. I, as a human being, can fail so many people. And in actual fact, I know that I'm not perfect. But you see, Jesus, the perfect one, will never fail you. So today, wherever you are, I want you to know that the one who is building his church will never, ever fail you. The second thing that I want you to understand, the implication, is that the church that Jesus is building, it is not a matter of an accident that happened after the cross. No, it was God's intention from the beginning. You know, when Paul writes a letter to the church in Ephesus, he says something that is very interesting in chapter 1, verse 4. He says, "For God chose us in him before the foundations of the world." In actual fact, before Genesis 1:1 was, you were. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And Ephesians 1:4 says, he chose us in him before the foundations of the world. So before he could even found the world, he had already chosen you. So know this thing. That in actual fact, wherever you are this morning, know that you are the chosen of God from the beginning of time. And that's why, that's the only way that Jesus is going to build his church. To remind us that we belong to him and he chose us in him before the foundations of the world. The third thing that I want you to realize in this text is that no one, no matter how powerful they are, no matter how powerful a teacher this person can be, no matter how powerful they can preach, no one can ever own God's people. So if you have heard people saying, no, this is my church, this is mine, and if you don't want, you can leave, and all of these things, you will realize that coronavirus has shown us that in actual fact, if Jesus wants to show you whose church is it, he will make sure that all of us are in our homes, and every one of us will pray, will worship, will dwell in his word, will break bread together with our families, because we belong to him. So I'm considering it a privilege even to be in a position of leading a church. Why? Because I know he is building it. And even now, as I'm sitting here in my house, right in this small study of mine, I am so comfortable with the fact that Jesus is taking care of you. He's taking care of your children. He's taking care of your needs because he is building his church. It actually helps me to help you to know that no one, including myself, can claim to own the church. So in actual fact, after this coronavirus, many of us should come out of our homes, and when we go back to the place of meeting, where we meet, where the church meets, all of us should come back and say, yeah, now we know that God can do this thing without us. He can do it without us, because he promised that he was going to build it. And so he did it even when we were in our homes. So how many people, let me just ask this question. How many people do you think they will fall from grace simply because the pastor is not preaching to them or is not in front of them on the pulpit on a Sunday? God loves his people, and God will keep his people, and God will protect his people. God will continue to build his church. And that's exactly what Jesus is doing. So let me encourage you today. I want you to go back and look at what Jesus was asking his disciples. I don't think they thought he will ask them this question, but I also don't think that they will hear this kind of a pronouncement. One of the reasons that I think the early church was this powerful was the fact that the disciples kept on going back to the fact that the Lord Jesus Christ himself said this, he did this, and we do as we saw him do. That's why these people were called Christians the first time in Antioch, because they lived like little Christs, if there's such a word. So because they lived like that, they were making sure that everybody knows and understands that Jesus is building his church. And so no one of us will own it. No one of us can come and claim that these are my people and this is my church. That's why it makes it a mockery of what we are doing when people fight, or pastors fight over people. We can never ever fight over people that we have never died for on the cross. And I can tell you, my friends, honestly speaking, I know that where two people are or three people are, there will always be challenges, because we think differently, we see things differently, and there will always be these kind of things that are happening in the life of the church. But let me tell you, we must never lose focus of the fact that Jesus is the head of the church, and he will make sure that even during this time, the church will succeed. Even during this difficult time, the church will grow. Even this during this difficult time, because he's building it, the church will come out of this situation healthy. We may do it differently after this. We may apply different methods after this. But I can tell you, what remains in his word will never change. Because he's not God that can lie. He remains the same. Yesterday he was like that. Today he's like this. Tomorrow he will still remain the same. We as people change, but God never changes. And that's why it is important to understand that you are not alone. When you are in your homes, and when you feel like you want to come to church, you feel like you want to meet with other believers and have a fellowship and all of that, I understand that. I love that, and I know God made us as relational beings. But this time, let me tell you, God has called you in your home so that he can have one-on-one with you. So that you can have one-on-one with your spouse. So that you can have one-on-one with your children. Some of us have grown so apart from our wives, from our children, because of something that we call ministry. Now God says, now sit down with them. Start it there first. Because I'm building you as part of my church. I'm building you, preacher, as part of my church. I'm building you so that you can go out of this situation and be a better person. And so for me this morning, I want to say to all of you, guys, one, trust that Jesus will never make a mistake in how he builds his church. Two, he has got the best interest of everything you are and what you have at heart. Three, he will come through in a way that you have never seen before. Because most probably some of us were a stumbling block to those kind of things, because we made you to believe that without us you cannot access God. Without us your prayers cannot be heard. Without us, you need to via us. And sometimes I look at these kind of things and I'm like, sometimes we are not very different from people who want to talk to, and our own ancestors. You talk to them, they will talk to God on your behalf. Christians have actually slipped in this kind of mentality in the life of the church, especially those of us who lead. Because we always wanted to believe that people must know that without us, God cannot hear them. But know that God will hear you, and he wants to come through for you and your family. Next week we'll continue with this thing, and I want to build a bit around it, and I want to build on some of the things that I haven't touched today. But today I wanted to say to you, during this crisis, let's know that God himself is building his church, and none of us can change that, and none of us can take that away from Christ, because the church that Jesus is building is perfect, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it,
and this is the way to go. Let's pray together. Let's stick together. Let's share bread together. And these 21 days, let's make sure that we feel the presence of the Lord. We come closer to Him and even go to Him directly without interfering and say, God, what do you want me to do? Ask those kind of questions. Have an intimate relationship with the Father. And God will show you what you've been missing all along during this time. God bless you. We love you. And we will meet again next week. Amen.